Hallelujah. Amen. So we're talking on how to be led by the Holy Ghost. How many know God wants to lead you? He wants to guide you. But he doesn't, you know, have this big foghorn thing. He says, hey, Brian, turn left at the next street. You know, it's something we learn to do through a relationship with him. And we've mentioned this, that you don't just get saved and then just automatically start hearing from God, just go straight up. Generally, it's kind of you learn some stuff and you practice and you kind of go around and then you hear it again and then, oh, yeah, it makes sense. And so you get a little higher and then you practice that and then you get a little higher. And it's kind of more like circles going up rather than just a straight line. Like, you know, I think some people think, well, I got saved and I don't even know everything already. What's the problem? And, you know, it takes time to develop in the things of God. Hearing from God takes time, amen, and you're not going to hear from God and be proficient in all those things overnight, amen. And so we've talked so far about the inward witness, we've talked about the inward voice. The inward witness is one thing, the inward voice is quite not quite as much information. Then we talked last week, which I thought was really good, about perception, which is more of a, when you get that perception from God, you just know what you need to do and where you need to be. And we've talked about all that. You just need to go listen to that if you want to. And there are some other ways that God speaks through visions and dreams, which I think are the more popular ones. But I think they're the ones that people get more messed up on. Because everybody, I've only been in this for, 33 years. And it seems like people are always wanting to have a vision and a dream. They want to be on the Damascus Road and get knocked off their donkey, get blinded, so that they can know it was God. Well, this whole thing is, it's a faith deal. Amen. You start out believing God and then learning how to tune in and then learning how to hear and walk with him. It's not a, wham, hallelujah, now I know what to do. My whole life is planned out. Well, then you probably won't follow God. Amen. We don't like it, but God likes this one step at a time thing. And sometimes it's take a step and wait. Hello? No, I was talking to God. I'm like, God! And then it's take another step and wait, you know. And sometimes we think, well, God, just tell me what I'm doing for the next month and let's get this taken care of. And he's like, no, because you'd probably leave me. You know, there's a reason that a lot of people don't win the lottery, because we'd have to probably go to Reno or Vegas to start a church to get them to come, because they'd be gone gambling or doing something foolish with their money. Amen. So God, get this in your heart. God likes one step at a time, and you learn to wait on him. Everybody say, wait. How many know we don't like to wait? I don't know about you. I hate waiting. Amen. And so I want to talk about something tonight that I think generally unhelps people hear from God. Is that a word? Unhelps. And that's confusion. In my dealing with Christians and people, well, dealing for people with 64 years and Christians for 33 years, you know, a lot of people are just confused. And a lot of Christians are confused, and they don't know how to deal with it. They don't know what to do with it. And I believe that the devil, he uses confusion to keep you from going straight with God. He likes you to be confused rather than just moving forward with God. And so he brings circumstances into your life that bring confusion. And it's been my observance that a lot of Christians spend more time observing confusion than they do the Word of God. Amen. And so their main thinking is confused. They don't know what to do. They're like the proverbial deer in the headlights. They're like, and the devil's just having a heyday with them because they haven't learned to overcome confusion. Are you out there? So if you would, turn to James chapter 1 with me. Y'all okay? James chapter 1. Now, everybody say, I am a Bible-believing, Bible-reading, believer. If I'm a believer, that means I'm a doer. Because it's not what I know, it's what I do. Amen. Amen. See, there's a lot of people. Can I just tell you, there's a lot of Christians that don't know their Bible and don't read their Bible. And if you want to get confused, be one of those. Amen. The best way to get into confusion is to be a Christian claimer without being a Bible reader. Just claim to be a Christian, and the devil will be on you like stink on rice. White on rice. Stink on a skunk. Something like that. What's stink on? What's the stink on? Is it stink? That was gross. I'm not going to, you do not get to answer anymore. But do you understand what I'm saying? You know, if the worst thing you can do is claim to be a Christian and not be one. Because if you claim it, the devil's going to put a big bullseye on the back of your head and say, well, they're talking about it. We're going to knock them out before that really gets to be true. And you watch, and the Bible talks about it. It talks about people that, you know, the sower of the seed. It talks about the people who they hear a little bit and just enough to get really excited, but the devil comes immediately to steal that word so that it won't produce anything in their life. And there are millions of people that qualify that way, and they've had the word, the goodness, the blessing, the promises stolen from them, and they're wondering, well, God, why isn't this working? And it's because they never got into the Bible themselves. If you're in this church, you better be a Bible reader. If you don't read your Bible, go to another church where there would be more people like you. Amen. Well, if you're not going to read your Bible, you're just going to be a problem. You're going to have problems. You're going to want me to fix all your problems. And, hey, kids, I don't have time to fix your problems. I got my own. Are you out there? Are you understanding what I'm saying, though? Don't go to another church. Just read your Bible. But do you hear what I'm saying? It's impossible to do this Jesus thing without being a Bible student. And it's impossible to do the Christian thing being confused all the time. Amen. So James chapter 1, verse 2 says this, my brethren, count it all joy, hallelujah, when you fall into various trials, tests, and temptations. Hallelujah. Not because of the test and the trial, but count it all joy because you know God's working on my end of this deal. Amen. If you're in faith, you just rejoice because this isn't the end deal. If I'm in faith, God's going to take care of this problem. Amen. And so while I'm in the trial doing my thing, standing in faith on the word of God, God is in the background. Remember I told you this last week, a lot of times we think if we're not moving, God's not moving. But I told you this, if you're in faith, if you're believing God, if you're in the will of God, when God is moving, you might be standing still. But you know this, God is moving somewhere on your behalf to get you where you need to be, into what you need to be, or whatever the situation. Amen? Say, God is working on my behalf, even when I don't see anything. Amen. So verse 3 says, knowing, when he says knowing, that means you experience this. It's not just I think about it. It means I experience, I know. Yeah. I know, listen, I know that the testing of my faith produces patience. Yeah. When the problem comes up, I know that as long as I stay in faith, patience is being produced in me. Are you out there? But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Patience keeps you in joy. Patience is what keeps you in joy. Some people, they're only in joy. Their joy is like a roller coaster ride because they haven't developed patience. And so they ride the roller coaster of life. Their joy depends on their circumstances and their friends and who they're with or what's not happening to them. That's their joy. When you understand patience and you realize I'm here in patience, and no matter what's happened to me, God's on my side. He's working in the background. And while I am in faith working on that problem and God's working on that problem, patience is working on me. Amen. Patience is working on me. How many of you know none of us like patience? Come on, don't look at me like that. Nobody likes a long line. Dear Lord, can I just go to Costco and find the longest line I can find? Now, which gas station line has the biggest line? I think I'll go on that. No, I want the one I think is going to move the faster. Get me out of there because I don't want to sit there all day. I have important stuff to do, and you're the same way. Amen. Amen. But patience helps you stay cool and calm and collected when the trials and the tests are coming. Amen. When you're in faith and you know the answer is coming, it's easier to have patience. But you have to be at this a while. You have to understand that when you're in your faith, you're actually believing, you're expecting the answer to come. I think about this all the time because I watch people, and I think a lot of people think that faith is just wanting something. Yeah, I want one of those cars. Yeah, I want to be healed. That's not faith. Faith is an absolute expectation on the Word of God that you positively have it before the words are out of your mouth. And when you have that, then no matter what's happening, you know God's on the inside and He's on the outside and He's working this thing out. Are you out there? I don't care what's happening in your world. If you're in faith believing God, He's working on it. If you're in faith. If you're not in faith, well, we have more scripture for that. Amen. But see, if you can only be happy when things are going your way, y'all look at me now. If you can only be happy when things are going your way, you're on the roller coaster. Paul said this. He says, I've learned to be content. Rich, poor, hungry, fat, no matter what the circumstances, I've learned one thing, to be content. I'm not moved by my circumstances. My circumstances don't move me. God is taking care of the situation. You know, a lot of times people say this. They say, well, God's in control. And what they mean generally when they say that is, I don't know what to do, but hopefully God does. But when you're in faith and you're really believing God, then you can rest and you can actually say that God's in control. He's got this because I've stuck Him on His Word. I've got His Word in my heart and my mind and my mouth, and He is working on this. He's got it in control. Are you understand that? You know, some people say, well, it's que sera, it's God's got it, and they don't have a clue what they're talking about. They're irresponsible. You didn't like that one. Amen. How many know you're not going to necessarily have a daily miraculous breakthrough? I don't mean to burst your bubble, but, you know, I think some people think every day is going to be a miraculous bubble bursting, miraculous day. Hallelujah! Can I just tell you something? Some days you just got to get down to the nitty gritty and work some. Work on your faith. Can I just be honest with you? One of the biggest problems I have, and some people probably still think I have that problem, the biggest problem I had being a preacher was being nice. Am I right? My wife's sitting there going, mm-hmm. I had to learn how to be nice. I didn't like being nice. I didn't want to be nice. Well, what? You want me to tell you what your problems are? I could go to each one of you and help you out. But see, if you don't know what it is you have to work on, you ain't working on it. Hello. And you have to get in faith of God and get hooked up with God to fix a bunch of your stuff, their stuff. And stop expecting circumstances to be nice to you before you be full of joy. If you're waiting for life to treat you right so you can be happy, you can forget it. Are you out there? You need to learn how to get in faith and stand in faith. You know, I think everybody ought to be filled with the Holy Ghost. with the evidence of speaking in tongues. You ought to pray in tongues all the time. Every day for 14 hours. It'd probably help the rest of us if you did. But the thing that gets me is the people who say they get filled with the Holy Ghost and then they want to fix everybody else. It's like, dude, are you kidding? You need a mirror? You have some serious flaws. And they're like, who's that? It's you. When you get filled with the Holy Ghost, He will begin to work on you and make you more palatable to the rest of us. And then you can begin to walk in some success in your life. We're going to start a new series next week, my wife and I, on happy together marriage. That's thanks, Kara. And if you haven't gone to my Facebook page, go to my Facebook page, like our picture. I've got a picture of us in 1974 when I turned 25 and we'd been together, I don't know, 6, 7, 8 months or something. And then a picture of us this year or last year. We've got 40 years of us being together. Do you know that we've learned some stuff in 40 years that wasn't much fun half the time? But if it hadn't been for the Holy Ghost, we wouldn't have made it. She would have been dead, or I would have been dead. Probably me. Are you out there? But thank God for the Holy Ghost. And thank God for some decent teaching that told us to listen to the Holy Ghost. Are you out there? Somebody asked me if they could do if I would counsel them, some marriage counseling. And I'm probably still not very good at being nice. But I said, no. I don't counsel. If you'll just come here and listen to the messages, if you'll read the Bible, if you'll get filled with the Holy Ghost and obey Him, you won't need counseling. And, you know, I don't mean to be rude, but do you know who takes up most of pastors' times? People who don't want to do their own work. I don't have time for that. Sorry. God can fix you. I can't. And I don't want to listen to you. Amen. Now, my wife, she'll listen to you, but then I have to listen to her when I get home, or when she gets home. So. But listen, we don't ignore our problems, amen. We get our faith working on the problems, and we don't let the problems steal our joy. Are you out there? Because when your joy is stolen, you don't feel like listening to God. You don't feel like obeying God, do you? So while your faith is working on the problem, patience is working on you. Amen. See, when Satan comes at you to create a problem in your life, you know, whatever he can dream up, you know, I was thinking about this. I asked, where'd Aaron go? I asked Aaron, he does, what's that called again? It's airsoft. It's some kind of, it's not a game because adults do it. I said, what's that game you play? He says, that's not a game. I'm like, oh, yeah. But they go out and they play army with pretend guns. Huh?
Boys and their toys.
And he really enjoys it. But what if whatever you were shooting at the enemy, bam, bam, instead of him going out, he just got stronger. And every time you shot him, he'd shoot you back with something bigger. And then he got to where you couldn't hit him at all. And the more you tried to hit him, the bigger and badder he got. You'd quit chasing him. Patience is that to the devil. God gave us patience so that whenever he attacks you and you just grin at him and start quoting some scripture, he's like, I was supposed to take you out. You're not supposed to be smiling and quoting scripture to me. And every time he shoots you through patience and faith, you just get stronger and bigger. And see, the more you exercise your patience, the stronger you get. Listen to him. You are not going to grow spiritually without a battle. It'd be like Alex. I'm going to use my man Alex. It would be like him laying in bed every day going, come on, muscles. Natalie, they're not getting any bigger. Well, honey, roll over. Would it be foolish to expect his muscle to get bigger without actually lifting some metal? Working on some machinery? I mean, Alex, I want to come down and sign up. I want 16 months of tutorial with you, but I don't want to touch any weights. No machines or anything. You just help me get in shape. Alex would be going, well, give me your money and I hope you're not disappointed in 16 months because you are still going to be looking like you look. Yep. Listen, you don't learn how to win by just reading the Bible and hoping nothing comes your way. You learn how to become strong in the things of God by believing God, and when the fight shows up, you do some speaking of the word and you do some standing in the dust, and when the dust clears, you still stand in there, and then you learn how to fight. Amen. Are you out there? I'm helping me. I'm having fun. I don't care about what you... But see, we actually get stronger and better the more fights we have. We're Josh Chamberlain. Well, even Nate. Nate's taken Krav. And Josh Chamberlain's taken Jiu-Jitsu. Hannah takes... What do you take? What? Five different styles. That's all mixed up. But these guys are taking some martial arts and learning to defend. I think all, a lot of kids should just take martial arts. Just stick them in martial arts. Don't have to worry about the bullies then. Just smash the bully. You want more kid to fight? Yeah. Rather than get beat up? Yeah. Have the kid kick some. But listen, while they're doing martial arts, you don't even know how good you're getting unless you fight somebody else. I mean, wouldn't it be wild? We're going to have a boxing championship of the world and only one fighter. I guess he wins. But we don't know if he's any good because he's never had anybody up against him. And see, that's the way a lot of Christians are. I want to be super Christian, but I don't want to fight. God, their prayer is, oh God, don't let anything ever happen to me. And so nothing does. But God wants you to be strong. And he wants you to learn how to rely on patience and faith. Faith and patience, the power twins. How to receive the blessings from God and how to not be intimidated when a fight shows up. You know, if I can be honest with you, I wish I'd have had a dad that was a professional fighter that when I was in the fourth and fifth grade would have taught me how to defend myself. So I could have kicked some stuff instead of always getting mine kicked. But see, if you don't have a dad or somebody that's going to tell you how to fight or just put you in and say, go do something. Then you lay around and you just get beat up all the time. And then you have a really lousy self-esteem. And that's the way a lot of Christians are. They haven't been taught to fight. They just pretend, well, the Lord knows. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, baloney. You ever read the Old Testament? All those guys did is fight to possess. God said, "Take this is yours. Now go take it." Well, wait a minute. I thought you said it was mine. Yeah, it's yours. Why do I have to go take it? Because that's the way I work. Now go get it. It's yours. Go get it back. That's why so many Christians are sick all the time, is the devil comes to steal their health, and they're like, oh, help me, Jesus. And God's like, would you get in the Word and take that back? Get that healing back. What in the world are you letting the devil steal your healing for? Does it make sense to anybody? Because most Christians and people are so confused, they're not even fighting the right battles. The devil's got people so confused about, oh, dear Lord, what should I do? What should I do? Oh, my, oh, my. And what should be happening is that the devil comes up and he blasts you with his best shot, and you just go, praise God, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Bless God in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And what he does, I bet my neighbors hate me. Because what he does then, he says, man, this is a waste of time. I am not hitting this guy again. I keep getting my hiney kicked. I'm going to the neighbor's house. You just want to see him work at the neighbor's house and leave your house alone. Yeah. Right? Because whatever he's hitting you with just makes you stronger. He's like, this is stupid. I ain't doing this anymore. Amen? But you go, you get, oh, I missed a car payment. Oh, God didn't show up. Oh, God. He's going, ooh, missed a car payment. I wonder what else I can get them with. Ooh, they fell for that. What do I want to get them with? Ooh, yeah, they're kids. Whining little Christians, always whining, always having trouble, and then blaming God. But God is sovereign. Really? Then why did he tell you to do stuff? Huh? Amen. Huh? You paying attention down there? All right. Go over to James chapter 5, or chapter 1. James chapter 1. Can I just tell you something? Whenever I see those pictures of the limp-wristed little Jesus with the lammy poo, I want to pull them down and break them. You ever see those? Poor little dainty Jesus. Buffet. It's like, Jesus went to hell and defeated the devil? Really? Got nailed to a cross and never even whimpered? Really? I bet Jesus was the most man you ever saw. Oh, that sissy, and all them sissy, who was it? What's that movie, Son of God? Which one? God's Not Dead. Got the preacher as the most wimpy guy in the whole movie. Christopher, we need to make a real movie about preachers. Where are you? Why aren't you up there? James chapter 1. Now listen to me. Confusion comes when you don't know what to do. All right? But listen, God's got an answer for us. James chapter 1, verse 5, it says, if any of you lacks wisdom and you're confused. I just put that in there, but that's what it says. That's the Sundholm version. If any of you lacks wisdom is confused, let him ask God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. Man, how do you get strong in faith? You try one, and you find out, yeah, okay, I could do that. Then you try another one and you go, yeah. Some people, they're trying, oh God, I just need a brand new BMW. Hey God, learn to believe God for a dollar. Get good at that for a while. Try that. See if you can get a dollar coming in on a regular basis. And then maybe, you know, move up to the smoke from a BMW or something. But I mean, really? Because how am I going to not doubt? By having success. I stood, and I wasn't moved. I believed, and I got an answer. ooh, so now I'm going to try something harder. You know, it's like these guys, you know, they're not trying to go from a black belt down to a white belt. They're trying to go from a white belt up to a black belt. You know, they're not trying to get less, get easier. Oh, I've been a Christian a long time. I hope this gets easier. It ain't. It's going to get harder. Oh, Pastor, don't tell me harder. I don't want to suck it up. It's going to get harder. But I don't like harder. I know that's why you're whining. But let him ask in faith with no doubting. How much doubting is allowed? If you're, now listen to me. If you're just wanting to be healed, or you're just wanting a new car, or you would like one, that's not faith. If I can talk you out of it, you didn't have faith. If you don't get it, you didn't have faith. Well, how will I know if I have faith? You'll get it. You'll have it. Before you even ask, you'll know it's yours. Well, how do I get there? You started believing for a buck. I mean, we went to Raymond, we're believing God for tuition every month. Believing God for tuition. It was cool every month. It showed up every month. Believing God just to make it. We made it. It's not hard. But you have to have some consistency. You got to have some stick-a-to-itiveness. And you can't be whining every time something don't work out.
It's the day before it's due. I don't think it's going to come. It won't.
Are you out there? Man, God is good. God is so awesome. He is so awesome. Let him ask in faith. With no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. Look at this. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. When you're in confusion, you're double-minded. Are you out there? And you know what the sad part about this is? You can be right-minded for half the time and double-minded for half the time, and the right half doesn't count for anything. You still ain't getting squat. So you might as well go for being right-minded all the time, get out of the confusion half of the time, and start getting someplace with God. Amen? But how am I going to do that? I'm going to ask for wisdom. God, I need some wisdom. How many know you need some wisdom? I need wisdom. You and I, we all need wisdom. And God says, if you'll ask me for wisdom, I'll give it to you. You are not supposed to be in a confused state of mind all the time. You're supposed to have an answer for everything that comes up. What? Yes. You should have an answer when the problem arises. See, don't allow confusion to become a regular part of your life. Yeah, when I first got into this, and I got into the, you know, transforming your mind through the Word of God and all that stuff, and one of the things that Brother Hagin used to talk about was right and wrong thinking and not letting the wrong thoughts stay in your head. He says it's just like the birds, you know, you can't stop them from flying over your head, but you can at least stop them from building a nest in your hair. And he was relating that to this, and this, man, it really helped me. You can't stop the thoughts that come, but you get to choose which ones to think on. Just because a thought comes doesn't mean you have to meditate on it day and night and worry about it. If it's not a good thought, let it go. And I've had people tell me, well, how can you control your thoughts? I'm like, are you serious? It's your head. Kick them out. I can do that? Yeah. But you have to know who you are. You have to know it's your head. Is this too much? How am I doing? Okay. Lester Summerall, I love this. Years ago he told us, he said, you will have plenty of opportunity to be confused. I was thinking, man, that's good news. He says, every day I get up, I have plenty of opportunities to be confused myself. But he said, I made a decision years ago. Look, he says, I made a decision years ago not to be confused. He made a decision not to be confused. And he said this, he said, I've learned to eliminate whatever is causing the confusion in me. Huh? You need to learn to eliminate what's causing, you know, and as a pastor, and most of you guys, you've probably been involved with all kinds of dealings with people, and you get people, and you're trying to work something out, and you're trying to work something out, but it's just not coming together, and you can't sleep at night. That's confusion. Get rid of what's causing the confusion. Well, what if I did? Just get rid of it. Eliminate the confusion so you can think straight. Well, what if it ruins this deal? You'll get another one. Huh? Learn to eliminate the confusion. People cause confusion in your life. Eliminate them if they're causing confusion. Dear Lord. Well, I don't want to be mean to them. Well, then go along and be confused for the rest of your life. Well, we have to love them. I said this before. You, in following God and being a Christian, you are not going to be able to make everybody happy. Get over happy land, okay? Some people you're going to have to love from a distance. Are you hearing me? Don't think that everybody that comes along the path, you got to love them, hug them, and hang out with them. If they cause confusion in your life, dump them like a hot rock and move on. You don't have to hate them. You just move on and walk in love. If that's your spouse, I'm sorry to hear about it. Amen. But it goes right back to following peace. If there's no peace, there's no movement. Amen. Are you following me? I said, are you following me? And so God says, if you lack wisdom, ask me, and I'll give you some. Turn over to 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 3. Y'all okay? Man, you getting anything out of this? I am. I've never heard any of this stuff before. That's awesome. God's good, isn't he? Kristen, are you a certified snorkeler or skin diver now or whatever you are? Probably not a skin diver. What's a skin diver? Scuba diver. I knew it was one of those words. Just got back from Cancun. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 5 says this. Now watch this. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon. Y'all remember Solomon? Son of David, king. In a dream by night, and God said, ask, what shall I give you? And Solomon said, you have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in truth, in righteousness, in uprightness of heart with you. You have continued this great kindness for him, and you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, how many know you ought to be nice when you're talking to God? Be nice if some people are just nice when they're talking to people. You have made your servant king instead of my father David. Look at this. This is a man who's a king. But I am a little child. I do not know how to go out or to come in, and your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore, give to your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil, for who is able to judge this great people of yours? The speech please the Lord. Man, I don't know about you. If you want to please God, ask him for some wisdom. Yeah. Stop some of that goofy stuff and say, just Lord, give me some wisdom. Man, you want God to do a happy dance? Say, Lord, I need wisdom. God's going to go, oh, hallelujah. Somebody finally got the question right. Amen. You didn't like that one? Okay. The speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. Then God said to him, because you have asked this thing and have not asked for long life for yourself, nor have asked riches for yourself, nor have asked the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern justice, behold, I have done according to your words. See, I have given you a wise and understanding heart, so that there has not been anyone like you before you, nor shall any like you arise after you. And I have also given you what you have not asked. You know what I like about obeying God? When you just obey God out of a good heart, He gives you stuff you don't even ask for. Other people, they're like, oh God, I need this, I need this. Man, we get stuff dumped on us. We get so blessed all the time. God is just good to us because we're just, God, I just want some wisdom. I want to obey. Amen. And he, verse 13, and he having also given you what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be anyone like you among the kings all your days. So if you walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments and as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days. Hallelujah. So Solomon asked for one thing. He didn't ask for riches. He just asked for wisdom. How many know? Turn over to Proverbs 4. How many know if Solomon the king was wise enough to ask for wisdom, maybe that'd be good for us? Are you out there? Maybe wisdom from God could help you with what you're doing, what you're going through. Are you out there? Man, I'll tell you what, this is exciting stuff. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7, and you got to almost read the first part of it. Now, this is my personal promise Bible. Does anybody have one of these personal promise Bibles? You have one? What a personal promise Bible is it has my name in here. So Proverbs 4, verse 1, it says, listen, Rod, to a father's instruction. That's what it says in the Bible. Pay attention and know understanding, for I give you sound learning. Don't forsake my law, for I was a son to my father, tender and an only child in the sight of my mother. He taught me and said, this is Solomon writing this, and we just read where he asked for wisdom, right? But he's telling us in Proverbs 4, he says, I got that wisdom from my father, who taught me to listen and to obey. Can I just tell you something? If your father is telling you to listen and obey, I would suggest you do it. If you don't have a father to tell you to listen and obey, you need to find one. Amen. Because the wisdom that Solomon had came from the wisdom that God gave his dad. And then God enhanced that wisdom. And if you don't have, you know, parents in your own family to encourage you to obey and to listen and to understand and to seek wisdom instead of be stupid, you need to find somebody. Young people. There's enough stupid people out there, okay? That spot doesn't need to be filled anymore. What we are lacking are some young people with a good mind who actually have a plan and a purpose for their life other than just to get stoned and cause trouble. It's a thought. There's enough idiots to go around. Thank you. And so he says, Proverbs 4, he says, verse 7, he says, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom. And in all you're getting, get understanding. Exalt her, and she will promote you. She will bring you honor when you embrace her. You should always ask God for wisdom. When something comes up, say, God, I need wisdom. Help me with this. And then don't move. You know, just don't run off. But I can guarantee you, you're going to say, okay, well, when did I get it? You just act like you got it. And when the situation comes up and your mind starts saying, you don't know what to do, you say, I know what to do. I have wisdom from God. I don't know what to do. I don't know when to do it. I don't know how to do it when I need to do it. You need to talk to your head. I'm serious. You need to tell your thoughts sometimes just to shut up and leave. Man, if you haven't learned how to tell your mind to shut up, you need to hang around here some more. Because you need to learn to, you know, the spirit man's the leader here. Not the mind, not the flesh, the spirit man. And the spirit man will speak to your mind and say, shut up, mind. That thought is not from God. That thought is not becoming God. Shut up. And you'd be amazed how those things will obey you when you know what your authority is. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to get about done here. Amen. But I want to say this again. God does not bless hearers of the word. He doesn't bless those that know the word. He's not blessing you because you've listened to every sermon I've ever preached. He blesses you when you do something with what you know. Amen. Poke your neighbor. Say, he's talking to me right now. There are some people, they've got every tape Brother Hagin, Brother Copeland, everybody ever had, and they're still defeated. Their life still is a toilet. And it's not because the word doesn't work, it's because they're not working the word. They're not doing something with what they know. Now, I learned this years ago, back in 1982, from Brother Hagin. And he's taught this for as long as I've known him. But he said that when he first got born again, or we got spirit-filled, and as a little pastor, he'd go into his church a couple times a day. And he'd pull out his Bible and turn it to Ephesians chapter 1. And he kneeled down the steps. And I've done this. I started doing this in 1984, 85, when we were associate pastors. Because I need wisdom. But you can't get wisdom thinking you're not good enough. And you can't get wisdom without asking. And so he taught us to pray this prayer this way, this prayer of Paul. He says, I pray that the God of my Lord, y'all reading, you got your Bibles open, Ephesians, now, listen to me. In order for this to work, you're going to have to do it three or four times a day. Just because you hear me say it tonight, it's not all over. It's like, wow, that was good. And don't come up to me and say, Pastor, that was an awesome sermon. I know it was. You come and tell me, what are you going to do with this awesome sermon? What are you going to do with it? Because if you ain't going to do nothing with it, it isn't any good. It's only good if you can apply it. Are you out there? If you can actually do something with it, then it's good. If you're going to do something with it, then you're going to become a winner. If you don't do anything with it, then you'll still have all those darts from the devil coming at you, and he'll like it because nothing comes back at him. And he said to pray this way. I pray that the God of my Lord Jesus Christ. Let me just read you this from my personal Bible. I'm going to start in verse 15. It says, for this cause I also have heard of Rod's faith in the Lord Jesus and the love which Rod has toward all the saints. That's positive, isn't it? I don't cease to give thanks for him, making mention of him in my prayers, that the God of Rod's Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to Rod a spirit of wisdom. Man, I want you that may give to Rod a spirit of wisdom. How many of you know it's just not wisdom? You ever met anybody that, I mean, they're just good at math? I mean, there's something, you know, I had to take Algebra 1 my freshman year at college. I think they do Algebra 1 in the fourth grade now. Math made no sense to me. I mean, once in a while I could get some stuff right, but math was like, huh? And, you know, some people are business-minded. Man, they can come up with business stuff, bam, bam, bam. I mean, they're making money, and you haven't even figured out where it is. You know what I'm talking about? And they have a, it's not just wisdom of business, they have a spirit of business. They have a spirit of math, a spirit of art. You know what I'm saying? I can paint, but nobody probably want to look at it. But there are people that, man, they paint, and it's like, wow, that is awesome. They have a spirit of artistry. And so he's praying. He says, don't just give Rod wisdom. Give him the spirit of wisdom. So that whatever he comes up against, he'll be ready for it. Look at that. He says that he may give to Rod a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God. I can remember, I don't want to bore you with the log truck drivers, but man, I remember I would do this. You know, after a while, after you do this, you don't need to read it anymore. And I can remember days in that log truck, and man, I'm reading through this prayer, just going through this prayer. And man, I'd come home, and I'm just like a six-month-old Christian, born again, spirit-filled. I'd come home, and I'd be telling my wife things that God showed me. Because he gave me the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. And I'm not trying to brag, but when other people that had been in church longer than I had, they couldn't even tell you diddly squat. Man, you know, not being prideful, but I mean, we just passed them because I got hooked on to, you need to ask God for wisdom. You can't just want it. I say, God, give me wisdom. And then you pray this. You put yourself in this. That the God of Rod's Lord, that Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to Rod a spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of him, having the eyes of his heart enlightened, that Rod may know what is the hope of his calling. Man. Let me read that from the Phillips translation. You all like that, I know. The Phillips translation says, that you may receive that inner illumination of the Spirit which will make you realize how great is the hope to which he is calling you, the magnificence and splendor of the inheritance promised to Christians, and how tremendous is the power available to us who believe in God. Wow! Wow! And you have all that, you run from the devil? You have all that power available to you, and when something comes up, you fold? Are you kidding me? The devil shouldn't even want to bother you anymore. He should be afraid of you. I remember when we first got into this, we were going to the Assembly of God Church in Klamath Falls, and man, I'm hearing about this stuff, and I'm trying to start to tell the devil where to get off, and people are like, now don't make him mad. Literally, we had him tell us that. I'd watch yourself, son. You get him stirred up, he'll come and get you. I'm like, bring him on. I'm serious. They're like, oh, don't get the devil mad at you. Like, man, I'll never forget today. This got in my heart, and I stepped outside of my log truck up in the woods, and I just opened the door, stood up there, and I said, come on, devil. You want some of this? Come and get some. And I was like, wow. He never showed up. You ever been around a bully? They only bully the people that are afraid of them. Bullies don't bully people that fight back. Even if the person fighting back can't beat them. Bullies only bully people who won't fight. And the devil is a primo bully. When I was in high school, going to Rex Putnam High School out there, I think it was my junior year, sophomore year, and when I was in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, man, I was in junior high in Kennewick, and there was this guy. I'd go in the bathroom, and he'd come in and stalk me. I'll beat the screen, I'll beat you. And I was a mama's boy, but no dad and nothing. I'm like, oh, I wish I'd had a dad that said, just turn around and kick him in the, do something, knee. You know what I'm saying? Man, dads, you're valuable, but you got to be a dad. Don't be a wussy dad. Be a dad. Are you telling me my kids should fight? Yeah, they ought to defend themselves. Oh, you think one team should win? Yeah, I don't want to be on a losing team. We're going to play sports. My team's going to win. Right? 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 Amen. And so he says, where did I go? And what is it? Now watch this. Rod may know what is the hope of his calling. How many of you know you need to know what God's called you to? Hello? You need to know. You can't fumble around for 50 years going, I don't know what God wants me to do. That's because you ain't doing nothing. You can't not. Do you know you cannot steer a parked car? If that sucker ain't moving, you can't steer it. Well, what if I do something wrong? You probably will. But at least get moving and God will steer you someplace. Now watch this. The inheritance in Rod. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards Rod? Because he believes. According to the working of the strength of his might. On the inside of Rod. Do you know what? Do you know who takes advantage of weak people? Bigger weak people. People who are strong don't have to push you around because they already know who they're strong. People who are confident don't have to make you feel bad so that they can feel better because they're already confident. The only people that have to make you feel bad are the weenies. The little boys in big bodies that have to act tough to scare you because that's the only control they'll ever have over you is fear. And so when I was a sophomore, I started taking karate. And I took karate for high school. And then when I went to Okinawa, I took Okinawan kung fu. And you know what? After 2 years of kung fu, nobody ever bothered me so I could kick their butt. You know why? Because when you're confident, you don't look edible anymore. Did you hear me? When you know who you are in Christ, the devil doesn't think you look edible anymore. But when you wander around in confusion, you're confused all the time. The devil says, yep, I got him. You football guys, you're playing football, you ever see, you're out there, and the running back's got the ball, and he's running now, and he's got two offenders, or defenders, I guess, coming at him, and he, you ever watch this on TV, he's like, whoa. What to do. And then somebody he can't see from the back smashes him. Because confusion will paralyze you. And you're going to get hit. Amen? Well, I don't know about you, but I had fun. Go ahead and stand up. Praise God. Tomorrow's Easter. Hallelujah. Easter. Resurrection Day, we call that. Amen? Hopefully we'll have a couple packed houses and we'll preach some good words.